of Storytelling, sponsored by the Georgetown University Alumni Association and Alumni Career Services. Thank you for taking the time to join us today. My name is Sarah Hay, Assistant Director of Alumni Career Services, and our presenter today is Mike Malloy, CEO of Waveborn. Today's webinar has been very well received by our alumni community. We had over 250 alums register and over 50 of you are on the line right now, so we're very glad you could join us. This webinar is sponsored in partnership with the Entrepreneurship Alliance, and if you're not familiar with them, I'll be sending more information to you about them after the webinar. Before we begin, I'd like to share a few housekeeping tips and reminders. Today's presentation is being recorded, and you can access the replay of this webinar within 3 business days on our YouTube channel. To access, simply go to youtube.com and search Georgetown Alumni Career Services. I've also directly sent the link to you in the chat area, and there are currently over 250 videos uploaded there. There are 2 audio options. You can listen via your computer speakers or dial into the conference bridge number provided. Participants are not required to have a headset, but are welcome to use one. It is important to note if you experience audio difficulties while listening via your computer speakers, this can be caused by having multiple software applications open. Feel free to close some of these applications or simply join us via the conference bridge number provided in your reminder email. Questions are welcome. Just type in your questions into the question area on your GoToWebinar control panel screen, and Mike will answer as many questions as time will allow during the Q&A portion at the end of the presentation. I will be emailing everyone a copy of his slides, and again, there's the recording, so don't feel like you have to write everything down. If you're having any technical difficulties, please submit those concerns to me via the chat area, or you can visit the GoToMeeting helpline on their website. And without further ado, I'll tell you a bit more about our presenter. As I said, Mike Malloy is CEO of Waveborn. He is also a professional Frisbee player who travels the world selling sunglasses and helping people. After 4 years at Deloitte Consulting, Malloy caught the entrepreneurial bug and knew he could not spend the rest of his life wearing a suit, sitting in a cube, and climbing the corporate ladder. He is now the CEO at Waveborn, a social good sunglasses company that donates a pair of prescription glasses or funds a portion of a cataract surgery for every pair of luxury Italian shades they sell. Malloy coaches Georgetown's Ultimate Frisbee team, serves on the leadership team for Hoya Gateway, and is always looking for ways to support the entrepreneurial ecosystem on the hilltop. He received his BS from Boston College in 2008 and his MS in Computer Science from Georgetown in 2012. And Mike has been one of our best volunteers this year, so I'm thrilled that we're able to bring him on in this capacity today. And Mike, thanks for joining us. I'll now turn it over to you.
Hi. Thank you very much for the introduction, Sarah. I'm really excited about the opportunity to present to you guys today and kind of share my experiences with word-of-mouth marketing and tell you a little bit more about the importance of storytelling. So right here is a little bit of an agenda of the topics I want to cover in the webinar today. First, I want to talk about the different forms of communication, both verbal, nonverbal, in-person, as well as leveraging several different types of technology. Then I will go into describing the structure of storytelling, the different components that are important to telling a compelling story, and what are some of the key aspects that lead to ideas spreading. I'll then talk about different ways that you can define your personal story and help you, the attendees, come up with a better description of what your one-sentence description is, your 30-second elevator pitch, that sort of thing. Then I'll go into a brief section on self-determination theory and how people find happiness and joy at work. And then spend a little bit of time talking about leadership and building your tribe of followers, and I think that's really where the strength and the power of word-of-mouth marketing comes from, is having a number of individuals in different communities and geographical regions who have a good relationship with you, believe in what you're saying, you're teaching, and have trust in what your messages are, and then are motivated or inspired or compelled to share them with other individuals that you may or may not have any relationship with, and that's kind of where the exponential growth and the power of word-of-mouth marketing comes from. And then talk a little bit at the end about how different people have different stories and go through a pretty lengthy recommended reading list. I've got some good resources and books and blogs that for those interested in learning more about word-of-mouth marketing can check out and spend a little bit of time expanding their understanding on the concepts that are introduced here today. So first and foremost, I think word-of-mouth marketing has been around for millenniums. Since the beginning of time, oral tradition is how people have passed down different ideas, whether it was in a cave, sitting around a fire, even when we were kids going to a Cub Scouts camping trip and telling ghost stories. Word of mouth is really how humans have communicated. I think it's one of the things that differentiates us from other species is the ability that we have to share stories and then continue telling them from generation to generation. I think if you look at Greek mythology, you can look at fables and popular children's stories, and usually within the story there's different components that people want to focus on and are important to remember as they pass it down from generation to generation. Maybe the names of the characters change, but the plot stays the same. The key lesson that you want to learn at the end of one of Aesop's fables is still continued to be passed down. So even though we live in a very connected society here in 2014 with everyone on their laptop and iPhone and iPad and all of these other different devices we can use to communicate, I think when you look at the core of human civilization, it's based on oral tradition and our ability to share ideas with those in our family, those in our local community, and now those in an international connected community via Facebook and things like that. So this is a great little slide. I think most of you will hopefully remember the telephone game we played in kindergarten, where we would all sit in a circle and you'd have a short little sentence. And you have to whisper it in the ear of the person next to you, and it would go around, and maybe it started with banana, but then by the time you got all the way around, it was Miss Shirley is in a band called Anna Rocks or something, you know? And what that shows and what that demonstrates is how stories get changed over the course of word-of-mouth marketing as they propagate through from the person telling the original story to maybe the two people who hear it, and then they each go tell two people, but maybe it's a little bit different, and then they go tell two people, and they all go tell two people. Now we've got 32 people hearing this story, but each step along the way, it's probably a little bit different. Some of the key components may be slightly changed, but hopefully the core theme is still there. And I guess to start, I'll give you guys a little bit of a background on Waveborn and kind of what the pitch is about our company and the story that I like to share. So Waveborn is a social good sunglasses company. We've been around for about 3 years now. And for every pair of sunglasses we sell, we give the gift of sight. So we donate prescription reading glasses to Unite for Sight, and we fund sight-restoring cataract surgeries through SEA International. With Unite for Sight, it's kind of like the Peace Corps for eye clinics, where folks will sign up for a year or two. They'll go abroad to places like Ghana, Honduras, or India. And they'll go there and they'll set up an eye clinic in these rural villages where patients will come in who've never had access to this sort of eye care. They get their first eye exam and they say, oh, like, you have terrible eyesight. You need 2.5 times magnifying eyeglasses. They pull a pair off the shelves, hand it them for free, and then we stock those shelves with our sunglass sales. This is what I believe is the key differentiator about our business and kind of at the core of why we're doing it is this social good component. And we have found, without a doubt, over the past 3 years, we've been able to grow and expand the business by leveraging various different word-of-mouth marketing techniques. We believe we have a very compelling story about the social good component and the work we're doing with these two great nonprofits. That's something people want to talk about. You know, this isn't just another pair of Ray-Bans that comes from Luxottica, this company that has a monopoly on the eyewear industry. No, we're a small company. We work with a designer directly in Milan, Italy. All of our frames are handcrafted. We get our lenses from Carl Zeiss, a leader in the optics industry. And one of the things that I like to do, and kind of an example of this telephone game, is that most of my friends and my peers know at least a fair amount about Waveborn and have heard me talk about it from time to time. So when we're meeting someone new, someone says, oh, tell me about Waveborn. Instead of me giving the pitch, which I've probably done thousands of times now and have it down to a science, I would rather hear my friend, who's maybe only actually talked about it 2 or 3 times, tell the story. You know, and as I mentioned, we work with Unite for Sight, and they work in Ghana, Honduras, and India. Maybe the person who's now passing the story along forgets the countries they're in or says some homeless blind kid in Africa gets glasses. You know, that's not exactly what we're going for. I mean, it touches on a little bit of the point that, yes, we're donating to those that are less fortunate. And one of the things that is valuable for you as someone who wants to be telling a story and telling it in a compelling way that it can be passed along is when you hear other people tell the story, focus on what are the parts that they remembered and that they thought were important, and how does that compare to what you wanted them to remember and what were the most important parts. you know, and maybe if people couldn't remember the countries, the next time I really want to stress G-H-I, you know, three letters in a row, Ghana, Honduras, India. Okay, guys, if I'm, whether I'm training brand ambassadors or just talking to somebody at the bar, this is a way to get them to understand, okay, these are the countries they work in, these are the key facts that I want them to take away. And it's fun to see as the message goes through what it is that people care about, you know? And I think that's very important for you and the stories that you want to be telling, and how are people viewing you as your personal brand or your company or your organization. You know, what is the story that they tell themselves and they tell others when thinking about that? So there's several different forms of communication that we use in society today. I've kind of broken them up into two segments, the right side being social media related ones, the left side being what I like to call kind of the different stages of communication. I would assume for a lot of you out there, you get quite a few emails every day, and that's kind of what I would say the baseline of communication. If someone needs something, okay, send me an email. I do have a pretty busy schedule, and I would say it takes me about 2 to 3 days to get to most emails. I'm not the type of person who's sitting there in my inbox and refresh and replying within 2 minutes. But if you need something a little bit more urgent, or you want to ask me a quick question, you know I'm not on my laptop for the day, shoot me a text message. As soon as I see that on my phone, I'll get you right back. Kind of the next level of communication is the phone call. I would say 5 or 10 years ago, this was kind of the core of salespeople and getting out there and getting your story told was, hey, get on the phone, go make cold calls. You know, we have a lot of folks at Waveborn who that's what they do. They have a lead list, and they'll go through and call all these different retail stores and tell them a little bit about Waveborn, and there is some success there. I would say cold calling has about like a 1% success rate, whereas going into a phone call meeting with someone that's been scheduled in advance that either you've already met in person or you received a warm introduction from a friend or a colleague, and hey, they're looking forward to it, you know you've got a 15 to 30 minute block lined up, there's an agenda going into the phone call, I think you can have very effective meetings that way. And kind of the next step is obviously the in-person meeting. Hey, let's get together for lunch. Let's go grab coffee. Do you want to come over for dinner? Hey, I'm going on a ski trip this weekend. Do you want to come? Obviously, in that intimate one-on-one or even in a group setting, being able to shake hands and see face-to-face with people, I still believe is the strongest form of communication. I guess I should have put webinars on here. This is definitely another way to communicate and broadcast an idea and get it out there so folks can share it. Sarah and her team do an excellent job of posting the video on YouTube, as well as emailing out the slides to everyone who signed up to attend. I mean, this in and of itself is storytelling. You know, the Alumni Career Services Department is helping to share Waveborn's story, as well as share the story that I'm trying to share with you today through this presentation and help you get a better understanding of word-of-mouth marketing and how does it work. So as Sarah mentioned, I did get my master's in computer science at Georgetown, so I've got a fairly strong technical background, and one of the best courses that I took in my program was an information retrieval class that basically helped me, or the project for the whole semester was to design a search engine similar to Google and understand how the kind of back-end algorithm works to select the things that show up when people search for things. And what this did was teach me a lot about social media and how does it work and how can you get your posts to be seen by more folks. I think I'll start with Facebook because that's kind of the easiest example that I think most people would be familiar with. As you know, you can tag people in pictures. You can now tag people in statuses. You can add a location. In the text, you can say, check out these at Waveborn sunglasses, and it'll turn Waveborn into a little blue hyperlink that will link to our Facebook fan page. For those of you who don't know, each of these little blue texts that you add to a post in Facebook boosts the ranking behind the scenes for this algorithm of how popular is this post, how relevant is this post, how likely is it to show up on other people's news feeds. Each time you're adding some more of these metadata about the post, and I guess metadata is data about data, that enhances the value of this post and it makes Facebook want to share it with more people. One thing that we've had a lot of success with at Waveborn, a couple different marketing techniques is like we will post a picture of a pair of sunglasses and say, hey, tag two friends and we'll pick a winner next, we'll pick a winner tomorrow and you'll win a free pair of sunglasses. And all of a sudden everybody starts tagging all of their friends, people get notifications, oh, I was tagged on this thing, what does it mean?
oh, great, I entered to win a free pair of sunglasses. I just got to tag another person. Awesome. You know, we've seen 30, 40, 50 people get tagged in some of our posts, some of these pictures, and I would say the core base, the first 5 or 10 folks are usually team members or existing customers, my personal friends, you know. But then it's really exciting when we get to see new folks who I don't know and who our other team members don't know, and now they're getting exposed to the Waveborn brand for the first time because we were able to use this sort of viral marketing technique with Facebook. So for those of you who do own your own business or are working with an organization, a company that wants to enhance their word of mouth marketing and getting people to talk more about it and share their ideas, I definitely think Facebook is a great place to start with that. If you do have your own fan or company page, there's also the option to spend a little money and promote the posts. That kind of helps them show up more, and now you're getting more impressions and people are seeing it. Twitter is, well, I call it the Twitter. I'm not an expert at the Twitter. It's a little bit too time intensive, and it's a constant ongoing conversation that really does need to be checked pretty frequently to take full advantage of it. That being said, there's a lot of power there. You know, I think one mistake that I see a lot of people do on Twitter is kind of creating their own hashtag and saying, hey, like, hashtag Shades That Give Sight are awesome, you should love Waveborn, or hashtag LOLOLOLOLOLOL. That one actually might be used commonly. But I think the important thing to remember when you're using hashtags on Twitter is that you're joining someone else's conversation. For example, for World Sight Day, we had several tweets that went out that said hashtag Be Shady. We didn't start that hashtag. Actually, Tom Shoes, that also sells eyeglasses that give back, started the hashtag Be Shady, and there was a lot of conversation going on Twitter from different organizations, individual customers and stuff, talking about what they were doing for World Sight Day. And we were able to join in that conversation and see some new followers follow us, Waveborn's Twitter account, as well as some retweets and favorites and things like that. Next up is Instagram. So as a sunglasses company, we do have a lot of pretty pictures of sunglasses. I'll often say that first and foremost, we sell pretty pictures of sunglasses before we actually sell the product. You know, as a primarily online e-commerce company, our website and the photographs of our sunglasses are kind of what gets us to that next step of, okay, hey, I want to go into one of your retail stores and try them on, or hey, I want to purchase, or hey, I heard you're doing a home try on this spring. I want to sign up for that so I can check the pairs out. Instagram has been great to get more and more folks checking out our pictures, as well as recently we've been able to leverage some folks who have like 50-plus thousand followers on Instagram or Twitter and have been taking photos and tweeting about Waveborn, and that's seen a big spike in other people talking about us. One example is I have a friend out in California that I saw 2 weekends ago at a beach frisbee tournament, and I gave him a pair of our neon pink moonlight sunglasses. And then Caleb happens to have, I think, 30,000 followers on Twitter. 2 days ago, he went to Taco Bell and took a selfie of himself wearing the moonlights and eating Taco Bell, and he said, the lady at Taco Bell said I look pretty. I love my new Waveborn shades. And then all of a sudden, we had like 150 people favoriting this, and 50 people retweeted it. And then next thing I know, Taco Bell with 1 million followers is tweeting at us, yes, we do think you look pretty, you know? And it's things like that, how stories can kind of escalate and spread as you enable people to talk about your product, your service, the good work that you're doing. Lastly, Snapchat is certainly a very popular trend these days for communicating, especially with high school students who, from my research, using Facebook less and less because it's becoming more filled with parents and teachers and that sort of thing, whereas Snapchat's a great way to just send a little quick selfie with a message to your friends. This certainly wasn't something that folks had hundreds of years ago when they were sitting around a fire, and it's pretty cool to see how we're now able to tell stories through Snapchat, through Vine is another one with videos. I know Instagram has videos now. I think this is what the next generation that's coming up, potentially some of the students at Georgetown now, and certainly other folks as they get more and more tech savvy and leverage social media to communicate. I mean, I remember when I was in middle school and high school, using like AOL Instant Messenger, and you know, what was your away message and who were you chatting with? So I just wanted to use this to kind of give a background on all of the different ways that we can communicate, and understanding that there's a lot of different techniques and strategies across all of these mediums that you can use to successfully tell your story, and most importantly, empower others to share your story. So when you're telling a story, it's very important that you build a good rapport with your audience. That story may be something you're telling to an individual. For example, I've been on a lot of sales trips recently for Waveborn, going in to talk to eye doctors, to talk to owners and buyers at retail stores. And there's a couple simple principles that I like to focus on as well as we train our sales reps on. The first is C, smile, eye contact, enthusiasm. That little combo platter will go a long way into having people welcome you into their store, into their home, to the bar stool next to them, whatever it may be. And now they're interested and excited to at least hear you keep speaking for the next 30 seconds, you know? We also talk a lot about creating a personal relationship. You know, you don't want to just walk into someone's place of business or sit down and ideally you would like their attention for 15 minutes. We'll start the first 1 or 2 minutes and give a little bit of background. Hey, how's it going? How was your holidays? What have you been up to? How's the girlfriend? How are the kids? Don't get right into the nitty-gritty of what you're asking them for. I think when you, one, if you already have a good existing rapport with them, if you've been friends or colleagues for a while, it's a lot easier. But especially as you're looking to build new relationships and you want to be telling people a new story and you want them to care and be engaged and then ideally share that story to their friends and colleagues, this sort of rapport building is an important kind of intro into that conversation. You can talk about different common interests you have, a local sports team, if you guys both went to summer camp together, or, hey, remember that weekend in Vegas? That was awesome. Things like that. And then you can also try to learn a little bit more about their personal lives. You know, people love to talk about themselves. One of the great things you can do is just listen. By blending an active ear and genuinely listening and caring about what people say, you'd be amazed at, one, what they'll share with you, and two, how likely and excited they are to reciprocate that level of attention when it's your turn to speak. One quote from the movie Hitch was Will Smith's advice that when you're in the room, be in the room. So again, it's important to focus that even if it's not your term, your time to be speaking, to be listening to what the other people in the room are saying so then you can respond insightfully and add to the conversation and to the story that's currently going on. So this slide talks about the structure of storytelling. This kind of template is a brief outline of basically almost every email I send. I'll start with a, hi Sarah, I hope that winter break has treated you well and you're surviving the snowstorm. We've got 4 inches here in Annapolis and I'm snowed in with a bit of the flu, but really excited to do the webinar tomorrow. You know, and I started with a little intro to Sarah letting her know how things are going. Hey, by the way, here's an update on how the webinar is going. I'm really excited to put it all together. This is what I've got so far. This is what I need from you. In that short, simple story, you want to, again, be as brief as possible, especially in the email format, 1 to 3 sentence paragraphs. It's really important to remember that in today's society, people's attention spans don't exist anymore. If you can get folks to pay attention for 30 seconds, great. If you're making a video and it's longer than 3 minutes, there's no way folks are going to watch it. Understanding that the more you can do to get people interested in the story, okay, great. And one thing that I like to do when I end each email, I say, hey, let me know what I can do to help you. Or what else do you need help with this week? Is there anything extra that I can send you that'll make your life easier? Cheers, Malloy. P.S. Boom, that's the hook. And in the PS section of every email, this is kind of a sales 101 trick, is that's where the hook is. That's where whatever you actually want them to do, you put it in the PS. I do have a tendency to be a little verbose and write some lengthy emails at times, and I'll talk about several different things in there. Maybe there's a link, and the biggest thing I need you to do is fill out this survey for HR. So I'm sending it out to all of our employees. Hey, hope the work week's going well. We're putting together the survey so we can analyze what the team looks like, where our locations are, what hours each week people are working, that sort of thing, blah, blah, blah. And then I'll include the link in the body of the text, but at the end I'll say, P.S., here's that link again in case you missed it. And then, boom, people may scan down the whole email, they'll read the P.S. and be like, oh, this is what you want me to do. Great, I got it. Another good lesson about this kind of strategy I learned from a book called The Last Lecture. It was written by Randy Pausch, a computer science professor at Carnegie Mellon, who passed away from cancer a few years ago. And one of the things that he would do is he had several pretty boring computer science research papers that he needed his friends and his colleagues to review. So what he would do is he would take the papers, print them out, and deliver them to folks with a box of Thin Mints, delicious Girl Scout cookies. So then a week goes by, hasn't heard back from somebody, doesn't know if they've had a chance to look at it. Instead of having to send them a follow-up message, nagging them to say, hey, did you finish reading that paper? I really need it, blah, blah, blah. He could just say, so how are those Thin Mints treating you? And that's it. He doesn't have to kind of go into the details of what's the status on the project. The recipient knows, hey, I got these Thin Mints as a reward for completing this project or tasks that somebody needed. He's asking about the Thin Mints. Yeah, let me get to that. Hey, I'll have an update for you by the end of the day tomorrow. You know, I think that's a great friendly way to kind of follow up with folks and understand that a lot of people are very busy and they do have a lot going on. Whatever your story is or the story that you want folks to be telling may not be on the top of their mind, but finding ways to follow up with them and get them compelled to answer makes a big difference. Another thing when you're thinking about storytelling is the audience. You know, is it an individual? Is it a group? Is it a group that, is it like a listserv that you're emailing out to? Is it a bunch of CC'd people? Is it a bunch of BCC'd people? Is it a MailChimp newsletter that's going out? Each of these, as you kind of go down, is kind of less and less personal. And so one thing that Waveborn did really well in 2013 was our crowdfunding campaign. And that's where a lot of our word-of-mouth marketing principles we were able to directly apply. And I'll kind of go through now a little bit of the crowdfunding campaign to share some of those experiences that can hopefully help you sharing your ideas and getting more folks to support the various causes that you're involved with. So as I mentioned, we launched a crowdfunding campaign on April 23rd, 2013, and our goal was to basically pre-sell the summer inventory. And over 45 days, we wanted to raise $10,000. And I didn't just wake up on the 22nd and say, hey, I'm going to do this crowdfunding campaign tomorrow. We actually spent about 2.5 months, myself and Mike McCormick, who's another Georgetown alum and one of my advisors that met out in San Francisco last year, spent about 2.5 months prepping for the campaign, doing research, putting together contact lists. And then what we did is we broke down our list of, I think I had about 1,700 different contacts from my Gmail, and I broke them into three tiers. And it's important to kind of, when you're looking at the people you know, to break them into these little groups. The first group is the most important one, and those are the key influencers, the people who have a large network, have people that when they talk, folks listen. You know, this may be professors you had in school or other business owners or presidents of different nonprofits or people you see who have 2,000 friends on Facebook and 30,000 followers on Twitter, people who have already built a tribe and a following. These are the ones that you know, hey, if I get them talking about my story, they're going to have a bigger, one of the biggest possible impacts by then broadcasting it out to their networks. And so what we did for, that was tier one. Tier two was our friends and family, anyone who's been supporting Waveborn and me, the founder and our kind of core team from the beginning. We wanted to get them an individual personal email before we launched. The same with tier one. They also got individual personal emails addressed just to them. And then tier three was basically everybody else. And what we did before the launch, we sent them a blast BCC message. So one of the things that we were able to do with the crowdfunding campaign that worked well is we wrote a lot of template messages. And I'll put together some materials, too, to send out afterwards that have some links to some of the various templates that we've used, template emails, template Facebook messages, template tweets, and also a training on how to make little quick click-to-tweet buttons so you guys can help make it easier for other people to share your stories. And I'll get a little bit more into that later in the presentation. What I did want to say about storytelling and the way you're, if you're sharing things via email, and when you send an individual email to a person, they're much more likely to respond and be like, oh, Malloy just sent me an email. He doesn't send me emails that often, so I guess this is pretty important. Like, what does he need me to do? Whereas if you get an email and 30 people are CC'd on it, the general reaction is, eh, this isn't that important. Somebody else on the list will do it, whatever. And so what we had a template message, and I could basically copy and paste the whole thing, and the template ended with the PS, and it was blank. And then for each individual person that we emailed, I would paste that, and then real quick type, PS, it was great to see you at that cookout 2 weeks ago. Would really love your support if you could back the campaign at the $50 level. You know, and I would let people know, hey, I am thinking about you. I did spend a little bit of time to write this message just for you, and also here's exactly what I want from you. And we would kind of say, what were the expected levels of donations? Maybe some people are giving $5 or $10, some people are $50, maybe some bigger fish are $5,000 or $10,000, you know? And so one of the things we were able to do by prepping so much before the campaign, we actually raised our entire goal, $10,000, in less than 36 hours. It was a pretty incredible feat, and due in large part to all the hard work that McCormick did before the campaign as he kind of led it. And it also goes to show the value of the network and the tribe and the community that I had focused on building over the past 3 or 4 years while working at Deloitte, and especially while going to Georgetown and playing Frisbee there. I've been on a number of different Frisbee teams, and I had a kickball team where quite a few folks back to the campaign, getting classmates from Boston College, family, friends from the neighborhood. Think about all of the folks that you have interacted with over the past year, the past 10 years, and who are the folks that, hey, I have this story, I have this new idea, this thing that I want to spread and I want to share. Can you help me do it? And ideally, some of those folks are going to say, yeah, you know what, I'd love to help you. This sounds like a great idea. What can I do to help? So now I'm going to get into a little bit of defining your personal story. So in one sentence, when people ask what I do, I say I'm a pro Frisbee player who travels the world selling sunglasses and helping people. That's not a thing. That's not what people say in fourth grade they want to do, but that's the life that I've designed and the story that I've built around the things that I work very hard at and enjoy spending my time doing. And you can kind of break it up into kind of three sections, the first one being a Frisbee player. First and foremost, I absolutely love playing Ultimate. It's the most fun thing on the planet for me, and there's a reason that I went to grad school, because I had eligibility to play at Georgetown for 3 years, and that's why now I coach the B team, and I work a lot with freshmen and sophomores at Georgetown's campus to help teach them about the sport, but also teach them about leadership and teamwork and help them figure out life a little bit, because I know I was pretty clueless when I was 18. And that goes well with the third part of helping people. Obviously, selling sunglasses, that is my business, Waveborn. That's our primary function is, yeah, we have high-quality luxury sunglasses that are manufactured in Italy that we sell to individuals, as well as right now we're focused on selling to retailers domestically and internationally. But anytime I'm doing one of those three things, I feel like I am aligned and supporting my personal mission, my personal story. So a challenge that I have for you, the listeners, is to think about, what do you do? What's your personal story? In one sentence, what are the key themes that encompass your focus in life, you know? And it helps you when you need to make decisions of, hey, there's two different options that I could work on. Should I work on, you know, this project of designing new sunglasses, or should I work on this project of going to a music festival? Well, obviously the one selling sunglasses aligns more with what my personal story is, so I think I should do that. And also the photo there is a sweet little grab I had at a beach frisbee tournament in Wildwood, New Jersey last summer. I was just out in Santa Monica, California a week ago for another beach ultimate tournament. So one way to help people tell your story is to write a book. I wrote my first book and published it about a year ago. It's called Becoming So Good They Can't Ignore You. And this right here is kind of the cover of the book, and it gives an overview of the key topics discussed there. And it's also inspired by another book written by a comp sci professor at Georgetown that I had, Cal Newport. And what it basically tells you to do is to adopt the craftsman mindset, the idea of putting your head down and working very hard and improving at skills. And as you get better and better, people start to notice, and then they start to talk about it. And they start to talk about you and say, hey, this guy's really good at this. You know, this is the story that I think of when I think of Malloy. He's a really hardworking guy. If you need help with computer science, or you need help with marketing, or you need sunglasses, or want to learn how to play Frisbee, go talk to this guy. So I recommend that everyone do check out the book. One of the nice things that I did, I was inspired to write this after reading Start Something That Matters by Blake Mycosi, the founder of Tom's. And I had found that Tom's Shoes has obviously been very successful. And throughout the year, they have a lot of specials where you buy a pair of shoes and they'll send you a paperback copy of the book for free, or it's for like 10 bucks on the website. I wrote this book for free. I self-published it. There's a PDF you can download online. It's about 60 pages. You can read it in about an hour. And I highly recommend you check it out, and hopefully it will give you some more insights into kind of what it takes to build a business or a company or organization that you're proud of. And as it grows, eventually you'll be able to leave your full-time job and kind of make that entrepreneurial jump full-time. And again, I'd be happy to talk with any of you after the webinar today to answer any questions you have about the book or anything else. And I believe there's a chat window open, too, that you can ask questions to Sarah that I'll answer at the end of the presentation.
Absolutely.
So one thing to note is that word-of-mouth marketing is based on the concept that you can't do it alone. This picture is a nice little team photo of the Waveborn team up in New York City this summer. We went to a launch event for the mobile app Hinge. I don't know if you've heard of it. It's a friend-of-friend dating app. The founder is a buddy of mine here in D.C. They were moving up to New York and having a neon disco party and said, hey, that goes well with our sunglasses. Let's go up there. Let's get the brand out there and see what we can do to have more people learning about Waveborn and then going and telling their friends. And again, the folks you'll see there is just kind of a small portion of the Waveborn team and those that have helped me in building the business over the past couple of years. Last summer, we actually had over 100 part-time folks working for us, and everyone was committing about 5 or 10 hours. It was easy for us to say, hey, we'll pay you on a commission basis, but more importantly, we're more focused on getting you involved with the Waveborn movement, sharing our story and empowering you to learn and grow and develop. We've had a ton of Georgetown Kern students and alumni work for Waveborn, several interns in our office at Punch Rock during the days, as well as I think we just hired 6 new folks that are Georgetown alums this month. And thanks again to Sarah, Bridget, and Whitney at the Alumni Career Service Department. They connected us with a virtual career fair networking event in October that introduced us to a great pool of candidates that I was able to kind of interview and eventually onboard this year. And again, I think the alumni network at Georgetown is a perfect example of who can help support you when you need to share your story and you want word-of-mouth marketing, you want people to be talking about and spreading it. It's pretty easy to find other Hoyas who want to support you and help you do well in your endeavors. And that's one thing that great leaders do. They develop other leaders. So there's kind of 3 key principles that I want to touch on real quick. The first thing is that the idea of giving people an assignment. So as a CEO at Waveborn, I have a lot of people approach me and say, hey, I'm really interested in startups. I love the company. I want to get involved. What can I do to help? That sort of thing. And the first thing I do is I think, okay, what's something simple that I need done that's going to take less than an hour? Okay, I give them an assignment. And it's interesting to see what happens and what people do with that assignment. I would say about 25% of the people I never hear back from. They don't do anything, nothing happens. Okay, that's fine. That's a blessing. They probably weren't committed, and it was going to be a waste of my time to work with them. And then there's about 50% of people who take the assignment, they get it done, it's good enough, but that's about it. You know, they don't really take it that extra step. And then the last part, that top 25%, those are the ones I love. Those are the people I want to hire that I want to work for in my business. They take that assignment and add 10 other things to it that I hadn't even thought of, use their own creativity, their networks, their skills to really go above and beyond and enhance what that assignment was. I can tell that these are the self-starters, the people who can take an idea and run with it. And guess what? They're also great word-of-mouth marketers. The second idea for leaders is the concept of show, tell, check, correct. When you're teaching other people about something, whether it's the story you want them to be sharing or how to do a business process at work, something like that, the idea of show and tell, obviously remember that from elementary school, it's easy to say, hey, this is how you do it. This is how you set up a waveborn.com email address. It's that simple. The next 2 steps are important. You can't just show and tell somebody to do it and then expect them to get it right the first time and get it right every time. It's important as a leader, you circle back, you check their work, and then you correct any kind of minor tweaks or things they need to be doing. I have found that this works incredibly well with our staff, assuming that you provide the feedback in a positive way and obviously building them and saying, hey, like, actually, no, this is kind of the way I want you to phrase that email. Like, let's change that PS message. I don't think that one's working. Let's try something new. And the last concept is the 5 levels of leadership. And there's a great book by John Maxwell that I'll talk about at the end that talks about as you become a bigger and better leader, you move up the levels of leadership. And the way you move up those levels is by pulling other people up with you. You know, so a level 1 leader is maybe like a simple manager, or he's got 1 person under him, and then he moves up and gets a little bit more leadership, and eventually you get all the way up to a coach of a Frisbee team or the CEO of a company, things like that. And I think it's important to realize, too, with these different levels of leadership, as you're involved in different things throughout your life, most likely you'll be at different stages in different communities. You know, I may be considered like a level 5 leader for the Georgetown Frisbee team, But when I'm going out in California and playing against some of the best players in the world, maybe I'm only a level 2 or 3. You know, I'm not quite a captain. I don't have all the expertise that those folks have. So that's something to think of is as you look at the different areas of your life, how can you enhance and level up in those different areas? So now I want to talk a little bit. There's a little short video I want to show about starting a movement. And this is by Derek Sievers, and he talks about the idea of a first follower and how to start a movement. And for anyone interested in word-of-mouth marketing, this is exactly what you want to do. So here's a little 3-minute video. I'll let this take over and then come back.
So ladies and gentlemen, at TED we talk a lot about leadership and how to make a movement. So let's watch a movement happen start to finish in under 3 minutes and dissect some lessons from it. First, of course you know, a leader needs the guts to stand out and be ridiculed. But what he's doing is so easy to follow. So here's his first follower with a crucial role. He's going to show everyone else how to follow. Now notice that the leader embraces him as an equal. So now it's not about the leader anymore. It's about them, plural. Now there he is calling to his friends. Now if you notice that the first follower is actually an underestimated form of leadership in itself. It takes guts to stand out like that. The first follower is what transforms a lone nut into a leader. And here comes a second follower. Now it's not a lone nut, it's not two nuts. Three is a crowd, and the crowd is news. So a movement must be public. It's important to show not just the leader, but the followers, because you find that new followers emulate the followers, not the leader. Now here come two more people, and immediately after, three more people. Now we've got momentum. This is the tipping point. Now we've got a movement. So notice that as more people join in, it's less risky. So those that were sitting on the fence before now have no reason not to. They won't stand out, they won't be ridiculed, but they will be part of the in crowd if they hurry. So over the next minute, you'll see all of the those that prefer to stick with the crowd, because eventually they would be ridiculed for not joining it. And that's how you make a movement. But let's recap some lessons from this. So first, if you are the type, like the shirtless dancing guy, that is standing alone, remember the importance of nurturing your first few followers as equals. So it's clearly about the movement, not you. Okay, but we might have missed the real lesson here. The biggest lesson, if you noticed, did you catch it? Is that leadership is over-glorified. That yes, it was the shirtless guy who was first, and he'll get all the credit, but it was really the first follower that transformed the lone nut into a leader. So as we're told that we should all be leaders, that would be really ineffective. If you really care about starting a movement, have the courage to follow and show others how to follow. And when you find a lone nut doing something great, have the guts to be the first one to stand up and join in. And what a perfect place to do that, TED. Thanks.
Cool. So as you saw in that video, I think that's one of the best examples of what it looks like to start a movement and what it's like to see word-of-mouth marketing really grow and expand. For me personally at Waveborn, I actually was not the founder. I was the first follower. Jonathan Schillett was a MBA student at Maryland who started the company, and 3 summers ago I got an email about it, said, hey, this looks cool. There's a Get Involved link on the website. And it was I had summer break before my last semester of grad school. I was still full-time at Malloy. And I said, hey, what can I do to help? You know, this sounds cool. I'd always liked sunglasses. I really liked the social good side of things. And from there, the company has kind of exponentially grown and taken off. And as I mentioned, last summer we had over 100 people working for us part-time. And that's something that I think you can do with a movement is you empower people to want to be a part of it, to want to talk about it, to empower them and excite them that this is something that they're a part of, you know? And a lot of people out there, and probably most of you in the audience, are not necessarily that shirtless dancing guy, you know? But it's a whole nother type of person to be that first follower, or even that fifth or that tenth follower, you know? You don't have to be the one starting, coming up with all these creative, great ideas, but you do want to be the one who shares the ideas and helps pass along that message to other folks. And I think there's a lot of cool stuff that can be done when we get groups of people together with similar mindsets. So in order to build your own tribe, it's important that you tell a story. Whatever that story may be, you want to connect the tribe members, the ones who believe in that story and are following the movement, with the other tribe members. So I asked you a question: who are you leading? Who are the folks that are following you? Are they employees? Are they members of a sports team with you? Are they family members? Are they the neighbors you live next door to? Who are the folks that listen when you speak and that want to go follow you down whatever path you're headed in your life? And I think a great way to do this is to establish a clear organizational culture. We've spent a lot of time thinking about the culture at Waveborn, and I mean, we are a social good sunglasses company. It's been designed from the beginning to be location independent, where if you work for Waveborn, you can go anywhere in the world that it's sunny and you call it a business trip. You know, that's kind of the definition of lifestyle design that I've tried to build into the company. And we also have a culture focused on learning and of building one another up and having positive feedback and encouraging people to try new things, embracing failure. One of the other great things about being a leader is it gives you charisma and the confidence to give a webinar or to speak in front of a large room or to walk into a room with the head buyer or owner of a large retail store and say, hey, you're going to buy my sunglasses. Let me tell you why. So a couple closing points and last couple slides to go through. It's important to remember that people have stories. The people that work for you, the people that follow you, the people that are members of your tribe, your community, your movement, they have a story, and you have a story. So always think about what is the story that other people are telling themselves about you or your brand or your company or your organization, whatever it may be, and understanding that in marketing especially, perception is reality. How are you perceived? What is the first thing people think of when they think of you, they think of your company, they think of your story, your project, whatever it is? You want that to be a positive thought. And there's a lot you can do to build that story up and to get people to like you and like the work you're doing before you ever really ask them for anything. It's a great strategy to build a nice reserve of political capital, if you will, to help other people with things. And then later on down the road, when you need something, they're ready, willing, and eager to help you out. So as I mentioned, here's a recommended reading list. I'll send this out afterwards and might actually add a few more to there. And I'll have some links so that people can check out the books on Amazon. The first one, The Hierarchy of Contagiousness, that kind of covers a lot of the science and the math behind how ideas spread and how word-of-mouth marketing can be so incredibly powerful. Platform, How to Get Noticed in a Nosy World, that's a great book about using the different social media platforms and marketing platforms out there to share your message. Purple Cow by Seth Godin. Seth is my favorite all-time author. I read everything he writes. He's given me so many great ideas and insights. And Purple Cow talks about being remarkable. To be remarkable, you want to be something that other people remark about, that they talk about. Not that they gossip and say, hey, who's that new girlfriend or whatever it is, but hey, did you see that Malloy did a webinar with Georgetown last week? That was really cool. There's lots of black and white cows. There aren't very many purple cows. So when you see one of them, you want to talk about it. Delivering Happiness by Tony Hsieh is a great book about their entire company culture and their focus on customer service. Freedom is Blogging in Your Underwear. That's a great book that teaches you how to kind of build a community of folks that listen when you speak, primarily through blogging online, obviously. The Five Levels of Leadership. Leading with the Heart is great. Great book about coaching, especially working with college students and getting them motivated to be team players and that sort of thing. A few other blogs that I'll send out some links to afterwards. As I mentioned, Seth Godin, Control-Alt-Delete is a good one. HubSpot has a ton of free white papers and different books on all sorts of marketing tactics that I've read hundreds of them at this point, I think, and we use them a lot at Waveborn for training materials. Neil Patel is an expert at SEO, search engine optimization, and finding ways to drive more traffic to your website. Under 30 CEO is a phenomenal platform with a lot of 20-something entrepreneurs writing great content. Speaking of writing great content, CopyBlogger, it has like a 20-day email series that will teach you everything you need to know about how to write better copy and how to tell better stories. And Margin of Excellence by Scott Mackey, that's another great blog that has it. They have on there a 45-minute MBA that you can download. It's a book to read, and it takes less than an hour. It's basically everything he learned in his MBA, which is a huge asset for me as somebody who got a MS in computer science and has never taken any business classes. I learned quite a bit from that. Scott also has a life planning kit on there that's a great goal setting activity to go through. So in closing, I want to ask you, what story do you tell yourself? I have found in my journey through life that most people are about as happy as they make their minds up to be, and that's usually dictated by what are the stories that we tell ourselves. So I challenge you to take a look at how you view the world around you and you view the work you're doing, the activities you fill your day with, and what makes you happy. And if you're telling yourself a positive story, I bet you're in a better mood. But if maybe you got a red light camera ticket on the way into work, and then you spend the whole day being pissed off about this $30, I don't know, $100 ticket that you got in D.C., that's going to bring you down. And one thing that I've actually been studying and researching recently is the fact that science has proven that when something bad happens, the chemicals from your brain that send out to your body to say, hey, I'm angry, I'm upset, it only takes 90 seconds for them to kind of do a whole lap through, and then you should be done being angry, you should be done being upset. If you're still angry, you're still upset, you're still dwelling on whatever this bad thing is that happens, that's your fault. That's something you can control, and that's dictated by the story that you tell yourself. And yeah, you can accept, okay, there's nothing I can do about that. I just lost $100 to this red light camera. That's fine. I have a meeting at 9:30. Let me get in there and go crush it and be in a good mood and share this great story with the people in the room. So that's one thing I want to challenge you to just think about is, what is your outlook on life, and how are you telling yourself a story about the life you're leading and the lives of those around you? And I bet there's a lot you can do to improve your quality of life by telling yourself a better story. Last but not least, here's an open call for a little question and answers. I think we've got about 7 minutes or so left. Sarah, I don't know if folks have been typing anything in the chat box or there any questions, but on the screen too, there's my calendar if you want to book a meeting with me, my email, cell phone. Feel free to reach out to me. I would love to chat with any of the attendees or anybody who watches the video on YouTube or gets to check out the slides. So, Sarah, how's it going?
All right, wonderful. Thank you so much, Mike. We do have a question here, and we have some more coming in, so I encourage everyone to see how much we can use this time. So, Mike, can you talk for a minute about how you've used short videos, if at all, to promote Waveborn, or what was your video marketing strategy? Where did you post them? How did you get them to go viral and all that?
Yeah, absolutely. So with the crowdfunding campaign and crowdfunding in general, 50% of the entire campaign is the video. So I think we ended up with a minute and 45-second video that took us a month and a half to make. So there's definitely a lot of time and effort that goes into developing quality videos. Like taking a little video on your iPhone is very different than like getting a professional videographer to film you and to post it. I would say YouTube is the best platform, the best channel for sharing videos. And then I'm still kind of learning my way around YouTube and getting. You can have a YouTube channel where you have subscribers and you can have links there. But the biggest thing that I found is keeping the videos short and simple. We did actually just publish like a 13-minute Waveborn State of the Movement address over the holidays. So that was something I had a videographer come over to the house for 2 hours, film me. We edited all the content together and basically overall update on what's going on in the business. I have found that was a very good platform to share all the exciting things going on. I think making little 30-second or 15-second or minute videos, commercials, is a great way to get people to learn more about your story. We have a lot of, we call them product porn, basically. It's just little short videos of sunglasses with some smooth jazz playing in the background, and hey, these are our luxury Italian sunglasses, and we'll send those links out on YouTube to different buyers, and I've had some really good responses from that. So I think that's a great way that you can use video to help tell your story. And I would say, in general, keeping videos below 3 minutes is a good rule of thumb for people's attention spans.
Okay. And can you think of a reason or a way to use Twitter if you are an attorney or maybe someone who wouldn't be able to incorporate it as much into their day-to-day work?
Absolutely. I think Twitter is an opportunity to build a platform as a thought leader. You know, I don't think you need to be live tweeting from the courtroom, but I think maybe spending 15 minutes or half an hour in the morning reading some blogs that are interesting or relevant to lawyers or those in your industry, and then just tweeting them. And what you can do is follow other people that are already experts. And one thing that I do, the most of the time when I tweet, I don't actually tweet things. I just retweet what other people said. So it's really easy to sound smart when you quote other smart people, you know? So finding people who are experts and then sharing their content. Like, I'll retweet a lot of the HubSpot marketing white papers when they tweet about them, you know, or different interesting articles about entrepreneurs and startup type stuff. That's a lot of what I read. And then I like to share that with the folks on Twitter. Another thing, I have my Facebook and Twitter linked up, so whenever I post a status to Facebook, it automatically tweets it, because I don't ever actually go in and tweet stuff. So that's one way. If you can link different social media accounts together using either Hootsuite or as an app called Buffer, that's a great way to have one succinct message, but then broadcast it out through several different mediums, knowing that I have 100 followers on Twitter, and I have 500 friends on Facebook, but only 20 of them are Twitter followers, and then I have 200 LinkedIn connections, but none of those are Facebook friends. If you can get the same message out to different channels, you have different people who listen to the messages you're saying on those channels. So that's one way to help. Yeah.
Okay. And Mike, can you talk about how you try and practice your storytelling through networking and other day-to-day either activities, clubs, small talk?
Sure, yeah. So I try to attend at least one networking event a week. I would say typically one networking event. That's kind of like my quota. We have a lot of sales quotas at Waveborn, and the idea is you just have to get out there and do it. A lot of people are, oh, I hate networking. It's not very fun. Like, I don't know what to talk about. It's awkward. Yeah, it is. It's uncomfortable. But I think, and this is a topic I talk a lot about in my book, is the idea of stretching outside your comfort zone. You know, that's how you get better at things, is by going to that place where it's uncomfortable and then meeting folks. And it's not that difficult to come home with a stack of 5 business cards. And the biggest thing that I recommend is, like, just shoot them an email within a week and just say, hey, it was great to meet you at that happy hour last week. We talked about marketing strategies for Twitter. Here's a white paper that I recently read about Twitter marketing strategies. Thought you might like it. Let me know if there's anything else I can do to help you. Cheers, Malloy. And I may not even throw a PS or a hook in there. This is me just genuinely reaching out and helping that person. I'm not asking for anything in return, but then a week, a month, a year later, that person likes me and they see, hey, I'm working on something and I need somebody to do something to help me, and they're interested in doing that because that's a new connection that I've built. So I definitely think that networking is important for entrepreneurs and for everyone in general. It's like, go out and make new friends. One of the things, I lived in a house before the folks in D.C., for the past couple of years, and when we'd come home after work, the two questions I'd ask my roommates is, did you make any new friends today, and what did you learn, you know? And so the idea of, hey, every day, go make a new friend. You know, talk to somebody that sits on the other side of the office or works in your building but works for a different company, or the cute girl at the bar, you know? By putting yourself out there and introducing yourself, this also gives you more reps at practicing and delivering your 30-second elevator pitch about what it is that you do, you know? And while it may not always work well, those failures can have some lessons learned for better strategies for the next networking event or introduction, you know?
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And Mike, where can we buy Waveborn sunglasses? And also, where can everyone access your book?
Yes, so you can buy Waveborn sunglasses at waveborn.com. If you are headed up to the Jersey Shore this summer, we just came back from a trade show last week in Atlantic City. We shall have our sunglasses in basically every beach town along the shore, which is pretty exciting news. We've got a retail store in Adams Morgan. Our main office is at Punch Rock at 18th and Wyoming. It's a co-working space for different social entrepreneurs. We've got our full inventory there, and that's also where I work most days, so happy to meet with folks there. And I will give you a link to download the book that we can send out in that email afterwards.
All right. Okay, perfect. So everyone, again, we will send you the PowerPoint slides, link to Mike's book, some other links will be embedded in the presentation, and you can go on our YouTube channel to find this recording. We hope that you'll tune into more of our entrepreneurship-related webinars this year. We also have some things coming up on giving presentations, so I think this will complement what Mike talked about today. So we look forward to seeing more of you all in 2014. And Mike, thanks for joining us. Best of luck to Waveborn. We hope it just gets bigger and bigger this year.
Awesome. Thanks so much, Sarah. Really appreciate it. Have a great day, guys.
Bye.